People complain that painfully slow-moving things are moving at a glacial pace. But how fast is that? How fast does a glacier actually move? We can't actually give a single answer to this question. It depends on the glacier because different glaciers have very different styles of motion. Glaciers form where snow accumulates so thick that it compresses into ice. Although ice seems quite solid, glacial ice slowly deforms under its own weight, spreading out and flowing downhill like pancake batter. At the edges, warmer air temperatures or contact with seawater cause the ice to melt away or break off icebergs that float away as they melt. This is the zone of ablation, where ice loss outpaces ice growth, as opposed to the zone of accumulation, where snowfall accumulates faster than ice is lost. Glaciers constantly flow from the zone of accumulation into the zone of ablation. Zooming into a cross-section view into a glacier, we can see how much influence the conditions at the base of the ice have on the glacier's flow. Where temperatures are freezing, most motion is due to the slow, batter-like flow of the ice deforming. But where temperatures allow for liquid water at the base, the lubricated contact between ice and ground allows the glacier to slide as well, greatly increasing its velocity. It also matters whether the ground beneath the glacier is bare bedrock or loose sediment, whether the land surface is flat or made of hills and valleys, and how steep the slope is. And where glaciers reach the ocean, flotation eventually lifts ice off the ground, reducing some of the friction up on the inland side. All these variables affect how fast glacial ice moves. This is why researchers work so hard to get to remote areas of the ice and measure ice velocity. The way that a glacier moves can help us figure out the factors that are controlling its motion, like the conditions down at the base, which are hidden beneath the ice. And that's important because of what all this means for sea level rise. I talked to two researchers who can help break this down, including a few specific glaciers as examples.
Ice flows but through a number of, couple of different mechanisms, but in the vast interior of the ice sheet, you go to the middle of Greenland, you go to the middle of Antarctica, it only moves a few meters per year, right? So it just slowly creeps along. It's basically just the ice gently deforming. Now, as the ice gets closer to the edges of the continent, it organizes itself into glaciers. And there, the velocities get up to 100 meters per year, 500 meters per year. And as it gets very close to the margin of the ice sheet and just before these things go afloat, 1,000, 2,000 meters per year. Some of the really fast-flowing glaciers, Jakobshavn Glacier, Helheim Glacier, have speeds of, 15, 20, 30,000 kilometers, basically tens of kilometers per year. So what happens to sea level is really what gets dumped into the ocean every year. If it's exactly the same as is evaporated out, nothing changes. What we're seeing is that more and more water is getting dumped into the ocean every year, then gets removed, boom, sea level rise. So then we need to know how much extra water is being dumped into the ocean every year. And so we need to know how fast the ice is flowing. One of the ways we do it is to put out, nowadays we use GPS devices, so we put in a stake, put in a GPS receiver on top of it, and it tells us what its position is today. We go back the next day or the next year, we remeasure it, and so now we know how far it's moved in that amount of time. What GPS allowed us to discover is that some glaciers will change their flow speed by sort of 50% over the course of a tidal cycle. And in one extreme case, Ice Stream B or Willens Ice Stream, it basically shuts down. It just stops moving. So it goes from zero to its full maximum velocity back to zero in just a few minutes. All of this is just incredibly surprising. If we'd put a stick there and then come back a day later, we'd have seen, sure, it moved a meter. And we'd been like, yep, check, moved a meter, so its speed must be 365 meters per year, let's go home. But if you watched it every minute, you'd have seen, didn't move, boom.
Other methods used to measure ice velocity involve satellite observations, known as remote sensing. This includes marking visible features in the ice as they move between satellite photos, and also the use of radar to map moving ice quite precisely. Because these techniques cover an entire ice sheet periodically, They can be used to detect changes in ice velocity over time.
We now have ice velocity observations from remote sensing every week, if not, you know, every 3 days for most of the glaciers around Greenland. And that's really allowed us to see the variability in ice velocities. And that's kind of why we're interested in studying it is, you know, we think of glacial pace as being quite slow. Glacial pace is not slow for a lot of glaciers around Greenland and Antarctica, and not uniform. Some undergo very large seasonal swings. So some will speed up in the spring and summer. Some actually slow down in the spring or summer, and a neighboring glacier might not feel that seasonal effect at all and just kind of maintain a slow and steady pace. What we can learn from the fact that it speeds up and slows down is what it might speed up and slow down to in the future in different climate scenarios.
So Thwaites Glacier is one of the largest glaciers in Antarctica. It's a couple hundred kilometers wide, 400 kilometers long, anywhere from a kilometer to 3 kilometers thick. It flows very slowly in the interior, starts out tens of meters per year, gets faster and faster. And the question that we're grappling with is, what is the acceleration over time? So 50 years ago, how fast was it flowing? What were the margins of it? The other really important thing that we use these velocities for is people are building these fantastic computer models, numerical models, to try and replicate the flow of the glacier. And they need something to aim for, right? So they need to build their model in such a way that they can replicate the flow speeds that we are measuring today. If they can't do that, then the model's no good. But if they can do that, then you get more and more confidence. This is a good model. Let's go ahead and use it to tell us what the Thwaites Glacier might look like in 50 years or in 100 years.
Helheim is about 6 kilometers wide and maybe 600-700 meters thick at the terminus. So it's very large. It moves about, 10 kilometers a year, 20 meters a day-ish at the front. It's very interesting because it comes out of a pretty steep slope farther upflow, and then it has a fairly flat 10 kilometers near the terminus. It is loose, where it's loosely grounded, and the grounding line shifts a bit because it's very close to flotation. Helheim is one of the big dischargers around Greenland, and really interesting because it seems to behave kind of counterintuitively. In a warm year, it might slow down, and in a cold year, it does something different, and you know, it'll have a nice pattern of speeding up and slowing down year to year, and then for 2 years does something totally different. So it's always kind of full of surprises. And it really struck us in having kind of siloed projects that we couldn't answer the questions that we really need. We really need to know what all these different components are doing. So our Helheim project that's funded through the Heising-Simons Foundation gave us an opportunity to try that. We have instrumentation, some on the ice. A lot of it is kind of near situ, we call it. So it's not on the ice, but it's still ground-based. So over there, LIDAR scanners that are scanning the ice every 6 hours to look at how ice velocity and surface elevation are changing with tides, with calving, with different seasons. One of the large questions in Greenland is which glaciers are going to be responding to, you know, changes in ocean circulation versus atmospheric circulation. And it seems like in many cases, Helheim is slightly more sensitive to atmosphere, but it's not, it's complicated. And knowing what's happening at the bed is, you know, it's always going to be the really hard part of glaciology. And so we observe where we can and hope, and it's really important to get these coincident observations for a long time.
All this complexity is critically important to projecting future sea level rise as the climate continues to warm. We need to understand, for example, how meltwater coming off of the ice drains down to the base and whether that could cause the glacier to speed up. Or for glaciers that have floating ice shelves, the friction of that shelf against the valley walls can slow the glacier behind it. Losing that ice shelf can cause the glacier to speed up. Or where shrinking glaciers retreat inland, the topography beneath their terminus can make them more or less susceptible to further shrinking. The velocity of each glacier can change in the future. The question is how and when. But while ice velocity is basically a matter of physics, sea level rise is only partly physics. The rest is human behavior. It's future greenhouse gas emissions that control future warming. Ice sheets are kind of like huge battleships that turn very slowly. They're gradually catching up to the current level of warming by melting faster and faster. But even if we were to halt global warming today, we'd continue to lose ice for centuries before they fully stabilized. That means that small differences between glaciers can be amplified over time, and it's why researchers are so focused on getting out and studying the behavior of each one. The ice itself may move at a glacial pace, but that's enough to change the world faster than you might think.